in the world of critters and nature. So we're going to let you take off.
Oh, well, hi. Can everybody hear me?
Yes.
Okay. This is one of my favorite topics. I think Ruth Ann suggested it. It's very light. It's very romantic. So anyway, that's why, and it's February, and that a lot of bird courtship. Make sure I stand where you can. Look here, not here. You've seen me. Look here. Anyway, this is typically when pair bonding starts, where courtship starts. With the smaller birds, your backyard birds, birds of prey start earlier. Greyhound owls start courtship in November. And usually by the second week of January, she's on eggs. If it's bald eagles and red-tailed hawks start earlier because it takes longer to raise the young. They're bigger and so on and so forth. But the younger, the smaller birds usually typically get started in February. The days are starting to get longer. The temperatures we think will start going up. We're not sure. And the temperatures are really important for insects, obviously. A lot of birds are fed insects or baby birds. Anyway, they just start getting livelier. If you watch your feeders, and since I've been living like Thoreau in my house, I spend a lot of time. You know, actually, Thoreau, every day would go in for his mama's cooking. So, I know, we think he lived there all that time.
Yeah.
Well, I have been living there all that time. Anyway, I watch the bird feeders, and typically, they all, as you know, if you've got bird feeders, in winter time, you've got, everybody comes, it's one for all. They watch each other's back. That's called a mixed foraging flock. And they take care of each other. If they see danger, one of them, it only has to be one that yells out, and they all disappear. If they see a cat, see a cooper's hawk. But this time of year, February, you're going to start noticing a little pushing and shoving, a little territorial stuff going on. So it's just, okay, it's that time. Anyway, everyone can see this, that love is in the air. Those are American avocets. That's a shorebird that is really western, but they do migrate to the Gulf. And occasionally we end up with one here, the only avocet I've ever seen. I saw here. They just get lost and end up along our shorelines. But it's a long-legged a shorebird. And look, they're pair bonding. The first thing you notice with pair bonding is two birds kind of hanging out together. They're kind of just there together. They like each other's company. Let's see if we can make this work. I just love technology. How about that? Okay. They're rubbing bills. That's kind of a normal thing. And let me think, the female is the one on the left. Her bill is a little shorter. Other than that, you wouldn't know. But pair bonds really come down to two words, guys. Two words. That's all. I could do this whole program and sum it up in two words. Female choice. Ta-da! No matter what we guys do, it's still female choice. They choose their partner. They choose who they want to be with. So that's just it. Guys, we can keep our hair combed. We can bow at the waist, but it's still female choice. So what does she look for? She obviously for beauty. She wants a good-looking guy. And this has all evolved over the eons. That's why we have 10,800 birds roughly on the planet, and they've all taken off on a different track, either male birds, and we do have gorgeous male birds, but if you've seen any National Geographic, you know around the world there's birds with all kinds of plumage and all kinds of colors. Female choice has driven that to be that way because she wants handsome. She also wants song. We have a lot of birds that really rely mostly on song, what they sound like. And all birds are incredibly vocal, but male birds typically have a territorial song that when they start to divide their territories up, they'll sing that and to attract the female. Attentiveness. Now that's something, if it's a new partner, is he going to be attentive? There'll be a time I may be on the eggs and need him to bring food. Will he? Can he? That's something she has to kind of guess at. Scratchy behavior. Some of the females is sit back and watch the male. She wants a scrapper. She wants someone that's really going to protect her. And his real estate, real estate, real estate. It's his territory. What he is claiming as his. And now she's not, we're not talking dynasty. She wants territory full of food for her young. So she'll have to say, I see plenty of berry bushes. I see plenty of insects, that kind of thing. So she's looking simply for that quality in his territory. It was interesting that this is one of the books on my bookshelf. That whole concept was really created or really dreamed up by what we call today a citizen scientist. He was not trained. He was from England, Elliot Howard. And he watched the birds on his estate. And he said, wait a minute. He figured it out that there's male birds dividing up little parcels of land. Now, as we get into spring, if you've got, depends on how large your property is. Say you've got two robins, they may split your property down the middle. And this is my half, this is your half. And they'll honor each other. Anyway, it was Elliot Howard that first presented this whole topic in 1920. And at the time, the trained academics, oh, come on, if this was real, we would have noticed it. But then the grad students, and the grad students' job is to prove their professors wrong, they read the book and started going out going, Mr. Howard's correct. Male birds are defining turf. So that's kind of where the whole concept began, 1920. And male titmice claiming territory. I watched this happen. This was the first year of my retirement. I don't know if you can see today, March 11th. And I was looking through the windows. You okay? Okay. I was watching the windows towards my bird feeders, and these two guys were chest bumping, bang, bang, bang. And I'm like, come on, guys. And all of a sudden, it was like the World Wrestling Federation. Bam! And if you look closely, each guy has the other guy by the eye socket. Uh-huh. And neither would let go. You know how guys are. They were laying there. And I finally walked out, standing above them. I thought just my presence would spook them. No. Well, then I took a photograph. And then I reached over my left hand and held in the same configuration. I'm not letting go. They both were so determined. And I could almost hear, honestly, I write nonfiction, a whimper. I don't know if it was both or one. It's like, come on, guys. And I finally just started waving my hand. They took off. That was enough, and I don't know who won. I don't know if they came back and scrapped later. But that really does show you, to a degree, the intensity you may see. You're going to see a lot of chest bumping. You're going to see a lot of chasing away around your yard. So that's what's starting to happen as we enter into February. Well, let's do this one. Gray blue heron. This is a bird that really wasn't here historically. This is a bird that we almost eliminated because of the plume hunters. Wanting those nuptial plumes. We won't go there because that's another hour-long talk. But we now have gray blue heron because their population has recovered. They've moved north. And TVA was gracious enough to change our river valley into a series of lakes and give us cheap electricity. But that's what drew in bald eagles and ospreys and these guys. Anyway, if you know, and I think you probably do, they nest in a colony. A rookery, a heronry, and in January, the first male back claims the best nest. May not be the one he built, but he claims it, and he stands there. This is mine. This is my turf. Don't even think about it. And so over the course of several days and weeks, all of the nests will slowly be claimed. And any male that gets there late, and there's no more nests, he has to start from scratch. So it makes sense to show up when it's 20 degrees in the second week of January. Now what happens next is obviously a partner comes, which I'd taken that photograph, I didn't. Both male and females have those long nuptial plumes, and that's really what, almost did them in. The plume hunters wanted those plumes for the women's hat. But when she gets there, now they don't have a huge dance platform, so it's mostly done with their necks and their bills. But hi, and it could be the same partner you had last year, because they spend their lives separately, except for this time of year. And it, did she make it? Did he make it? Anyway, so, and it may, his partner from last year may not come back, so he'll find a new partner. But that's what they do. And they click bills. Hi, how you been? I haven't seen you in 8 months. You survived. Click, 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 click. So that's already going on. The females, early February, are starting to show up. He's claimed that turf. He's determined to keep that turf. He got there early to get the one that views sunset. He wanted that beautiful sunset view. Now here I'm making that up. But if I was a male heron, I would want to see, well, I might want to see sunrise. I don't know. Anyway, that's what's going on. Who's next? Morning dove. When I parked and got out of the car, first thing I heard, morning doves tend to partner early. Thank you very much. Morning doves tend to partner early in the year. And the other night I was sitting there watching my bird feeders. The sun had gone down, there was still enough light, and there was a pair up on a branch. They were kind of billing. They were clacking those bills together, doing a little stroking of each other's neck. And, oh my goodness, right here. Anyway, they partner early because morning doves can do 6 clutches a year. So they got to get started early. They're very, very parental. They can, if all the conditions suit them, do 6 clutches a year, but only 2 eggs at a time. That's the optimum number, because you don't come and go from the nest that often to draw attention to the nest. Plus, they are intense parents. They both, the male bird does all parts. He helps build a nest. He helps incubate. He brings her food. He brings them food. So it is, they're intense parents. And that whole process of raising one clutch takes 6 weeks to 2 months, something like that. So that they start early. Oh. It's where the term billing and cooing comes from. Now, I've not witnessed this yet from my pair, but they were getting close. I kept thinking, oh, go ahead, nuzzle, nuzzle. And typically, they do this away from our eyes. They're private. They do it away. But here, they didn't know I was sitting there in my breakfast nook watching them. But anyway, that's billing and cooing, attentiveness. Who's next? Whoa. Cardinals. This is one you can almost help out with. If you've got 4, 5, 6 cardinals coming, male cardinals coming to your feeders, pick out which one's the brightest red to your eye. An unmated female cardinal will pick the brightest red male available. Notice he has to be available. And because not only is he good looking, but he's healthy. He ate the best diet the year before, including a lot of berries in the fall, because those are the red berries, flowering dogwood, and the such, hollies, that bumps up his red. So he's healthy. So she's picking, thank you, Ollie. She's picking out a healthy male. So now when you run home, and I know you're going to do this, look at your bird feeder. Oh, my God, look at that guy. That's the George Clooney of my backyard right there. So that's him. He's handsome. Anyway, they will start to spend time together. They will start being attentive with each other, being affectionate with each other. He may bring her food. That's telling her, okay, he knows how to find food, and he knows how to bring it to me. That's, mark that off the list. So that's one of the things he may do. And then they become a pair. I include this for one reason. See that female? She's watching him. She keeps her eye on him. Female cardinals also sing the territorial song. Cheer, 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 whip, 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 whip. Female, both the male sings it and the female. She's saying, this is mine too. Don't you think about it, sister. And she watches him. Don't you dare leave my side. Don't you dare. You stay in the territory bringing me food. So she's, when I was at IMS, I get calls all the time. I've got this cardinal banging into my window. It could be a male or female, but I had a call from Morristown once, and the guy said, Satan is trying to get at me by banging into the window. Satan? What does Satan look like? I'm just curious. What does Satan look like? He's a man in the guise of a male cardinal. Oh, you know, I think that's a male cardinal. He's just being aggressive. He sees his reflection and thinks there's another male in his turf. Females do it too. They'll bang into your car window mirror. They'll see. So if that happens, don't worry. They eventually figure out that it's not somebody else. And as far as the guy worrying about Satan, I really couldn't answer his deep questions there. I said, other than I was thinking, you got some guilt going on about something, but don't worry about it. Anyway, who's that? Oh, little chickadees. Chickadee-dee-dee. Chickadees have kind of a hierarchy. There's a pecking order. And over the course of months, and I read a wonderful book about this, there will be an alpha male and an alpha female that are honored. Okay. Oh, you want food? Oh, you go first. And then when it comes time to find territory, oh, you alpha male, you pick whatever you want. I'll get the leftovers. And so that's how they come about. Alpha and alpha tend to pair. Although I've read that alpha female may decide that she preferred beta male. It's her choice, and it may be his song. Their territorial song is seesaw. Now again, birds have lots of vocalizations, but they have a typical territorial song, and that's what you'll hear, very wispy. That's what the male, this is my turf. Very, very, very high and wispy. So that, and their secondary cavity nesters, they will look for a hollow tree, or they'll use a bluebird box. It doesn't matter, but that's what they'll do. Wrens. Ruth Ann knows about house wrens. We have three species, house wren, Carolina wren, locally, but then we have winter wrens in the wintertime, but they move to the higher elevation of Smokies. The males will claim turf and build multiple nests or start multiple nests. It's like, okay, not only is this great turf, surely one of these nest sites will please you. And last I was sitting in my screening porch last year, and there was one male. He was putting nesting material everywhere he could think of. Everywhere he could think of, he said, she's going to love one of these spots. She will. I know her. And finally, all of a sudden, she joined, and they finished the nest together at one spot, at a spot I could see. I went, oh, that's perfect. But I had them also nest in my reef on my front door. I had a coffee can. I made a coffee can. I cut a hole in plastic and Folgers. Knocked it, put it up on the house. They chose that too. So I really have multiple nests, multiple pairs probably. That was Carolina wrens at my house. They're the ones that have the white stripe. Weedle. Cheeseburger. That's kind of their song. But he goes, he said, I am going to find the spot she loves. Who's that? Mockingbird, state bird. I won't imitate them because there's too many. But a male mockingbird learns song phrases all of his life. They're open-ended learners. They don't. Most birds learn the basic vocalization the first year, and that's kind of it. But mockingbirds are open-ended learners, like catbirds and brown thrashers. They keep adding to their repertoire. So a mature male mockingbird, he's claimed his turf. He may know 200 song phrases. Say he's 6 years old, 7 years old, and he's just up there, and she's going, I'm never going to get tired of that playlist. Listen to him. He's a sign of maturity. And she's watching him, and maybe on the other side of the yard, there's a 2-year-old male mockingbird, and he knows 30 songs. She goes, my God, that's all he knows. Anyway, she chooses the mature one. She typically will choose the most mature male available. Males, and they gets deep in shrubbery, deep into a cedar tree, really hidden. And he builds the nest. And she comes and light and adds some little fine plant down to the inside of the nest, make it softer, and then he brings her food. So a mature guy must have been around, must know what he's doing. So that's the mockingbird, Tennessee state bird. Who's next? Crows. We hear crows almost every day. Almost every day. But when it comes to courtship, the male's a soft talker. He's a sweet talker. He moves in beside him. He's a sweet talker. None of that yelling stuff. Whereas the cardinal's about to blow his head off from yelling. Crows just kind of move in. Hey. So he sweet talks her. And this, start watching for this kind of behavior. I don't know if you can hear them, but that's your crows. We now know crows are corvids, and that's the smartest genus. He's learned he doesn't need to have to blast it out. He can just move in and be nice and vocal with her. So that's the crow. Who's next? Oh, blue jay. Whoa. I love blue jays. Some people don't like them. Too aggressive. Too pushy. But when a blue jay flies into your feeding station, all the other birds just think, oh my gosh, that's gorgeous. They're bigger than robins. If you really compare, they're absolutely gorgeous. Hard to tell male and female apart. He's slightly bigger. You can't compare unless you're side by side. But get this, starting in Feb or into March, you'll start seeing small flocks forming. Those are courtship flocks, female-led courtship flocks. A female will, next thing you know, she'll have 3, 5, 10 blue jays with her, an entourage. It's males. It may be some young females watching her thinking, I'm going to be just like her. I'm going to see what, and she will move, wherever she goes, they go. If she flies up here and stays there for 5 minutes, they fly up with her and stay with her for 5 minutes. Of course, when they're landing, all the guys are going, look at me, look at me. But then she'll move. She'll move. Wherever she goes, they follow. And it continues and continues. And over the course of days and weeks, some of the younger females say, okay, I can do this. They take off. And maybe some of the guys follow her. But over the course of several days and weeks, it's down to one guy. He has hung with her. He has said, wherever you go, I'm with you, right beside you. That then they will begin courtship. So you may see, again, you may see a whole group all of a sudden appear in the springtime. Small flock, not a large flock. But wherever the first one to leave is the focus female, and everyone goes with her. So, and blue jays are also corvids, are related to crows, very smart. They defy being studied. I've spoken to some of my friends who net birds and put the blank bands on them. Yeah, we can catch one blue jay and they'll fly up to the top of a tree and tell everybody, all the other blue jays, don't even go down there. So we have to move the net. So that's the blue jays. This is one of the great success stories of our country, environmental success stories. This is one of the great citizen science stories. We were losing bluebirds, 1920s into the 1940s. And one man, Thomas Musselman in Quincy, Illinois, he was retired. He was worked in academia, not a teacher, but looking for a hobby, started doing bluebird boxes. And going around like this and speaking to groups about the importance of putting up a bluebird box or the importance of putting up a bluebird trail of several boxes. And that small movement, which started in Illinois, slowly spread. The first bluebird box trail in Knox County or in our area was put up by two TVA biologists below Norris Dam. Dick Fitz, I'm trying to pull the other name out of my hat, but I can't. He'll come to me. As I'm driving home, the other name will pop up. But they were that was the first bluebird box trail here, and it was in 1968. So it spread slowly. Now I think many of us have a bluebird box. And many of us will have bluebirds. So this is a group we have. They were never considered endangered, just in a rapid decline. That was before the term endangered species ever came. But what happened, you put up a bluebird box. claim a box and stand on the box, show his gorgeous blue color, but it has nothing to do with how blue plumage you're born. You're born as blue as you're ever going to be. So you do mold, but you don't add to it. And he will claim a box, and a female will come in and look at his box, look at the real estate around his box. She's flying insects principally. And she may fly in and go check the box out. Could use a few rugs, maybe a lamp here, you know. But I like it. And he's attentive. And he may go fly and grab some straw or pine needles. They love pine needles, pine needles. And bring it back and say, look, there's pine needles right over here. Put it in the box. You go, okay, okay. You got nesting material and you seem okay. And there's plenty of food. And so then they're committed. Then they'll go. Then they go through their courtship, but they claim the home, and they'll defend the home. And if it's a mated pair, that partnership may last for the year. They may be claiming that home all winter time. It's like, okay, this is ours. We're going to keep it. So that's bluebird, eastern bluebird, secondary cavity nesters, obviously. But again, it's one of the great, great conservation environmental stories of our time is a single person can make a huge change, and he did, Thomas Musselman. American goldfinches, I think I added some of these as it happens, because goldfinches, we didn't have nesting goldfinches in the 1940s and 50s. We had them in the wintertime when they were drab and they would come to our feeders, but they would fly back north. We didn't have the one thing they really love. This is one species that's tied to a particular plant, thistle. And I read an article in one of the birding magazines that when we finished the Eisenhower interstate system, that created a giant sucking tunnel to bring thistle seeds down through here. And now we have in ditch lines thistles, and that's what they want. And thistle, they want the seed head. And usually May, when it produces seeds, the female not only feeds her young the seeds, but the plant down, like a dandelion, the carrot, that's what she lines her nest with. So he wants to find a ditch line or an acre or a vacant lot with thistle. And then once, I've spoken to a lot of garden club, and a garden club has said, how can I get goldfinch? Well, just plant a bunch of thistles. I can't do that. Anyway, that's what they look for. And once she's looking at him and his property, they'll fly around it. And goldfinches are one bird that can kind of sing while they fly. Particularly, and other tunes. So that's American goldfinch. It typically happens May into June. That's when the thistles are, thistle seeds are ripe. My favorite bird. Cedar waxwings. You never just see one. If you see one cedar waxwing scan, they come in groups, flocks, 30. I love cedar waxwings. There's a friend of mine who lives in Kansas, sent me a photograph, Betty. And, well, gosh, she just got one. She just proved me wrong. Anyway, when they start pairing up, they wait to June into July because this is one species that raise their young on fruit. So they wait for the first ripe fruits, like mulberries is what the first ripeness in my yard. But here they're courting, they're passing fruit back and forth. And kind of, I can care for you. I checked most of the cedar waxwing nesting. I'm not 100% sure why is up in the Tri-Cities area in Tennessee. We have some here, but that's where most of it is. And I assume that there's some kind of barrier. I got something I need to look up. But I love this photograph. A little bill kiss. I just love that photograph. This was a thesis I think I read. I think it was from the University of Alabama. I can't remember the grad student, but they got permission to catch a flock of cedar waxwings, put them in an aviary, and trying to start watching how they were pairing up. How? Why? How? And the only thing they found out, or the thing that they think they figured out, is, again, female choice. A cedar waxwing gets its name because of the secondary feathers along the trailing edge of the wing develop those little, for lack of a better word, dollop, look like old-fashioned sealing wax. And as they mature, both males and females have that, and as they age and get older and older, the little dollops are bigger and bigger and bigger. And it seemed to them during the thesis that the female will pick a male roughly her own age. His dollops match her dollops. So she's going for, oh, I'm 4 years old, you're 4 years old. I think we got some shared life experiences. I know I'm putting a lot of humans on that. But that's what she's looking for. Oh, don't fall apart, please. Oh, goodness. I forgot my stop time.
You're okay.
Well, just somebody say, hey, Lynn, we got other things to do.
We can go up till 11:45.
Okay. Oh wow. Okay, I'm doing fine. This is one of the great stories of how modern day stories, and I am talking past few year stories of how behaviors change, how songs change. This is a bird you have now. They spend their winters here. White-throated sparrows. They come either black and white striped noggins or buff and brown stripes. So there's two different morphologies. That's kind of interesting. They may be splitting somehow. Although there's the black and white striped males are more aggressive, and it seems from what I've read, the females like the other better because he's just better hanging around the nest, the brown above. So anyway, but what they've noticed, this is one of the first mnemonics I learned when I was doing this a long time ago. The mnemonic to remember is poor Sam, Peabody, 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 Peabody. Kind of two up notes, and then a long, and then three notes. Peabody, Peabody, Peabody. A new song emerged in Canada. And in Canada it's, oh, sweet Canada, Canada, Canada. Anyway, that's the mnemonic. But a new song emerged. One male, and we have to assume this was one male that started it. He lopped off that last note. It was hit the mnemonic now became, poor Sam Peabody, Peabody, Peabody. He left off the last. Whoa. The females loved it. And they said, wow, that's a new song. And all of a sudden, and this is really the first time I read about it, was something like 2019, somewhere in there. And the new hit, White-throated sparrow song, is sweeping the country, and it's working its way down here because female choice. She likes it, and the guys are saying, "I'm going to learn a new song. And it's easier. We leave off that last note." So this is what's going out there now. You probably won't hear them here, but you might as we get close. They're going to migrate north, probably not March. You might hear them start to practice. I'd be curious if you pick up the three note trail or the two note. Anyway, that's what's happening, and it does show you evolution happens quickly. Probably the best book I ever read on this topic in my life was The Beak of the Finch. God, I wish I'd have written a book. It's one of those books that go, why didn't I write this? But it really was about a couple, a married couple, that got to know every single bird on one of the Galapagos Islands, the Darwin's finches. Got to know every single bird. They had a band on every single bird, and they could watch how the populations changed over the course of just a few short years. So that's why, if you're interested in this topic, The Beak of the Finch, I love that book. Anyway, go on, don't digress. I've been throwing this word around a little. Love. Can we call this love? That's a very human emotion. Can't we call this love?
I vote yes.
Yeah.
Way to go. Me too. Who's next? Anyway, if you follow your French philosophers, Descartes, he believed that animals were purely mechanisms, clocks. They could not communicate. They could not care. They cannot even think about the other animals around them. They did not feel. They did not love. Obviously, Descartes never had a dog. If you've got a dog does all of that and more. So anyway, yes, and again, I've been reading the literature for a long time. You can see my hair is gray. And all of a sudden, in the literature, in the birding literature, I'm seeing the word love. This is a couple of, the book on the right is a book. It filled with photographs of family love. And this is a great video. I actually have this one, DVD, of a nature program called Love in the Animal Kingdom. Not only does it cover birds, watch it, but don't watch the ending. It'll break your heart. It will. It's about a pair of flamingos. Anyway, love being used. Now that's the popular media. Okay, popular media, you can use that, but we academics won't. We can't. That's a human quality. Until this came out. This is from Living Bird. That's a magazine produced by Cornell Lab of Ornithology. How do birds fall in love? They finally acknowledge, okay, the rest of the country is going to call it love. We can too, for everything I've just said. So this was a wonderful article, and some of the things in that article, including, I didn't use that particular photograph, but it shows what I have shown of a male cardinal bringing food in. And everything I've talked about is how birds fall in love, how they get to know each other, how they spend time together, and how they pair bond. So yes, birds love. There, Descartes. But what is love? What is love? It's simply caring, protecting, comforting, petting, mutual preening, providing for, sharing, active partnerships. That's love. That's love. And that's not necessarily just romantic love. You love your children. You love your parents. You love your friends. You do all of this for all of them. That's love. This is a question I most often get when I do this talk, and I finally just included it as part of the talk. Do birds mate for life? Do birds mate for life? Well, yes and no. That's a long commitment. A cardinal is lucky if it lives 8 years, so it's not a huge commitment. But yes, they tend to hang. Whooping cranes mate for life. And they live 50 years, as far as we know. And they start pair bonding about their second year. They start hanging out together. Just male and female hanging, just getting to know one another. And I've read in Peter Matheson's wonderful book about cranes that just doesn't work. And so the pair will just say, you know, we just didn't pair bond. And then we'll find a new pair bond. But roughly at age 5, when they're mature, they will start dancing together, similar to the great blue herons we saw earlier. And I wish I'd brought it. I should include it. There's a wonderful photograph of George Archibald, who founded the International Crane Foundation in Baraboo, Wisconsin. And he took in all the cranes from around the world to build populations. And George learned how to dance to get the female excited and ready to have a family. So I've got a great photograph of him dancing. I forget what kind of crane it is, but one of the cranes. But he learned how to dance that she liked. Bald eagles, they tend to mate for life. Now, this is not a mating pair. I included it because bald eagles don't become the mature-looking adult eagle until they're about 5 years old. And that's an adult on the left, and the eagle on the right is a 3-year-old eagle. A 2-year-old eagle is kind of solid brown, looks like a golden eagle. But as they mature, and typically like whooping cranes, when a bald eagle is about 5 years old, a male will start claiming territory. I love this photograph. A friend of mine, Shelley, sent it to me. This is a male taken in 2018 that claimed the river just below Gatlinburg. Gatlinburg's my hometown. I couldn't believe it. I said, Shelley, they like still water. That river's not still water. She said, I'm saying, but she's an EMT and goes to EMT and goes there to Gatlinburg routinely on her shift. And she said, it's been here, and I think it finally attracted a mate. But that's what happens. A male is claiming typically an area of still water. And when you think, this was sent to me by Barbara out in Tellico Village. That's a male and female starting to hang out together. okay, hi, start to get to know one another. And again, when they're 4 or 5 years old, that's when they commit. Initially, often their first year, they just build a practice nest to see how, okay, can we work together? Can we actually build a nest together? But they typically will the first year build a practice nest, but then the next year, the very first bald eagle nest ever in the history of Knox County was in Seven Islands, and they nested there 2 or 3 years before they moved downriver. But this is bald eagles and red-tailed hawks. They do this thing where they're circling each other, and then they hold each other by the feet, by the talons, and start to spiral downward. It's almost a trust mechanism. I'm with you. I'm with you until right then they let go and fly back up. And I read, I think it's a recent Audubon. Yeah, it was Audubon. A pair of red-tailed hawks didn't quite let go and they hit the ground again and went, I think we did that wrong. They weren't hurt. They just should have let go a few seconds earlier. So red-tailed hawks do the same thing. And I had friends call me 3 weeks ago and said, we're watching 2 red-tailed hawks do this. What's going on? I said, well, they're courting. Now, they, red-tailed hawks, bald eagles tend to mate for an extended time, maybe not for life, but an extended time. Or divorce. We'll get to that topic in just a minute. It's dark. Anyway, it was really in the early 90s that ornithology students started saying to their professors, how do we know when they mate for life? In the 1980s, all the books said a pair of birds mate for life, mate for the season, or mate for one clutch. That was the 3. And so grad students started saying, how do we know they mate for life? Well, we've always said it. Well, that doesn't make it real just because you've always said it. And so all of a sudden, if you're a grad student in the early 1990s in ornithology, you could get your thesis or your dissertation by studying a pair of birds as long as you possibly can. And by a pair of birds, or maybe a pair of birds that you catch and put leg bands on, so you can tell them apart from a distance and know that's my pair. And they would study them for a while, and then study them for a while, and study as long. And I read where sometimes that whole study would be passed on to another grad student, And then they found out that, indeed, some birds do tend to mate for an extended period. Whooping cranes and bald eagles are 2 in our area that do tend to nest or stay pair-bond for an extended area of time. But then they found out birds that were listed in the bird books as mate for life, they don't necessarily. And so all of a sudden, we get to the darker part, all of a sudden, in the literature, in the 1990s, I was starting reading the word bird divorce. Now the professors said, no, you can't use that word. Can't use divorce. Well, gee, what do you want us to use? Well, how about non-recommitment? Well, that's a little lengthy. So why don't we just stick with divorce? Well, divorce, just like bird love, the bird divorce is out there. I remember going on Lobby 5 at 4, and I'm watching the clock, Lobby 5 at 4 to talk about this topic several years ago because I was doing a class at IMED. And I mentioned bird divorce, and Russell Bivin, who's the biggest family man in the world, said, don't tell me bird divorce. I don't want to hear it. Sorry, Russell. But anyway, part of it is for practical reasons. I have another book on my bookshelf. This is a book filled with studies and theses about do birds mate for life? And if they don't, why not? And from this book, one of the theories is female choice. Birds mate for life unless the female decides it's not working. Now, it can be simply because his territory, she's having a lot of nest failures, and maybe that his territory is full of raccoons and they're destroying the nest. Maybe that there's simply not enough food in his territory. So she may say, God, I like him, but he's just not working. plays a clutch. Well, there's a probably a definite biological reason. When we have a family, it takes 20, 30 years to raise that family. For birds, it takes 6 weeks or 2 months, or a bird of prey, 2.5 months. So from a spread the gene pool around standpoint, from the biology standpoint, it may just simply behoove the species if they go, you know, we did great. We had 17 offspring, but let's put these genes elsewhere. So from a purely, and that's a study I've not seen yet, and maybe someone may be working on it, that it may simply be we've done our part. We've done our part. You go spread your genes elsewhere. I need to spread our genes elsewhere. No, that's biology right there, period. So it's not emotional. It's simply we just need this, and that's why birds are doing. There's 10,800 species of birds on this planet, so they're incredibly successful for some reason. And I think I'm done. I say intermission because I could go another hour, but we don't want that. Any questions?
When you say mate for life, do you mean both their lives or one of their lives? In other words, if one passes away.
Oh, beautiful. Great question. Did you hear if they're mate for life? No, if one passes away, there'll be a grieving period. And in some cases, corvids, there'll be a funeral. And that's the smart group. I recently read about a blue jay funeral for some. Anyway, they will find a new partner. They will find a new partner after a certain amount of time. Was that the whole question? Okay. Any other questions, guys? Yeah.
I know it's kind of a thing about how swans mate for life, is that true?
There, oh, I'm sorry. I should have broken that softer. No, I'm sorry. That was one of the, I mean, right, they thought, oh, our swans have been out there, but in the book, it's, no. Maybe 2-3 years, but not for life. Anybody else? Mary.
What does a blue jay funeral look like?
What is what?
What does a blue jay funeral entail?
Oh, sweet. He paused a long time because he doesn't have an answer. If you go to YouTube, there is a funeral for magpies. And that's the same, the smartest group, the corvids, are ravens, crows, blue jays, not just blue jays, and magpies. And I'm reasonably sure I watched, there was a deceased magpie. Did you see that? Okay. That had been hit by a car or something, and all, they paid homage. They came up to the, as if we would have came up to the body. And just to pay homage, and I'm guessing, but again, purely a guess, blue jays do the same. But I have read they have a funeral.
Thank you.
Anybody else? Yeah, Rick.
So, of course, I love the questions about whether we can use things like love and divorce and all that stuff. And we, you know, we have just done a series in Advent from, you know, one of the theologians who talks about interiority as being part and parcel of all of creation, mm-hmm. You know, and I think that's where Descartes, you know, Descartes did not see anything but humans as having a subjectivity, you know, as if they had an interior life as well as an exterior life, and so
we have a soul, the animals don't.
Right, and I think that's part of the issue when we say you're anthropomorphizing is that we assume that. They, like, when I look at you, there's nothing about you that I can say externally that's, how do I know you're not an automaton? You know, like, you're not, like, a robot, you know?
I think I'm half broken if I am.
Yeah, maybe. But the point is that, of course, you have a subjectivity, and of course, I can actually see that you do. I can see it, and we can feel together, like, your interiority affects mine. And so I argue that the same thing is true when we look at animals. You know, yes, you can be biased. You can be sad and look out at the sky and say, look, the sky is sad with me. But you can also, like, look into a dog's eyes and think, oh, that dog is showing affection to me.
Yes.
They have an interiority. And if you have an interiority, then I think you can use this language to talk about non-human species.
Well, that's truly, and that language is just really, like I've been saying, that's one goal of this talk. It's only been since the late 1980s and 90s that we started breaking down that, oh, no, no.
Right.
You can't use a human term. They're not human. We are human because we need that to separate ourselves from the rest. But again, we could be sly as a fox. We could be wise as an owl, so we could put an animal quality on us. We could be busy as a bee. But we couldn't do the reverse. But now we can.
Right.
Anybody else?
Yes.
Do birds, one more time, please.
They have like different size brains.
Different size brains. They have different size of brains.
Oh, well, certainly. Think of a hummingbird. It's mine, yeah, their brain is barely bigger than a pea. Probably not that big. They weigh 4 grams, which is less than 2 dimes, but that brain, they all migrate to Costa Rica or Central America, and no one shows them. So yes, they do have different sized brains, and some hooping cranes have to be taught to migrate. Anyway, I'm stammering around. Yes, they have different sized brains, but the corvids, that again, the corvids are considered the smartest. We used to define us as the tool maker. Humans are tool makers. Jane Goodall proved that was wrong, but now we know that jays and crows and ravens can make tools, can make complicated, can use several tools to complete a task. So we, anyway, yes, and the corvids have a modest sized brain. It's not as big as a bald eagle's brain, I don't think. I've never held the two together. Did that answer it all? Probably not.
The structures are similar, though.
Yeah, there would be similar structure. I take care of an owl. Little Dexter, I should have brought him. We think, and again, I used it, why is an owl? No. Owls have tiny little brains, and it's really these occipital lobe that interprets sight, and they're not wise. They have humongous eyeballs. Their skull is 2 large eye sockets, and tomorrow I'm out at Seven Islands talking about owls. And a tiny, tiny brain. So they're not, my owl's not sitting in its little enclosure trying to figure out world problems. It's just not. It's trying to figure out, what did I just hear? What did I just see? Anyway, I digressed. I'm sorry.
June had a question.
Yes, I'm coming back.
I had a story.
Oh, good.
I had to babysit with a cat here a while back, and the cat was in my apartment for at least 2 full days before it could see me and I could see it, practically. You know, this was going to test this out for sure. And the next thing I knew, about the third night, I felt something in bed with me. And up against me. And that cat was there every night. And in the daytime, the cat was more friendly. But it was, I don't know where it went that first few nights. But by the third night, that cat was going to be right up to my back.
Mm-hmm. It got obviously comfortable with where it was and comfortable with you.
I had it about 4 weeks, I think.
I'm sweet. How'd you give it up?
Yeah. I didn't like giving it up.
I know. We easily get attacked. Towhees are one bird in our backyard, and I'll try to pull it back to birds. If you see a towhee around your feeder, it is perfect. It feels safe. It trusts you. And they are the shyest, most hidden bird. That's a towhee. But if you start seeing them around your feeder and around your yard, and you're seeing them, they totally, totally trust you. They go, okay, I've watched this person for 7 years, whatever, and because they hide in the shrubbery, they nest in the shrubbery, and they find food down in the ground under leaves and things. But if you start seeing them, they totally trust you. It's probably the shyest backyard bird. Okay?
And then we have a towhee that lives out here in this
Uh-huh.
And when spring comes around, you got to park your car way down there because he thinks that he's seeing somebody taking over his territory in all of our rear view mirrors, and so our car's just getting trashed. Mm-hmm. Yeah. He hops all over the place.
No, no. Mine,